dreams.
You want fame? Well, fame costs. And right here is where you start paying in sweat.
Fame. How could you forget its name? Its high voltage music and high energy dance first lit up our screens in 1982. At the New York School of Performing Arts, music, dance and drama were on the curriculum, and jamming was on the menu at lunch. But does fame cost?
The price of fame can be so many things. It could be a marriage. It could be your health. It could be loneliness.
What did fame cost me? It cost me my youth. My youth, I could have been a regular kid. No, it didn't cost me at all. It bought me some fun musical toys.
It's really like a lack of sleep and anxiety. You know, that's a cost. You know, you have a lot of pressure on yourself.
Yeah. Price of fame could be enormous. The cost of that, maybe some sweat and some tears. But sweat and tears aren't always a bad thing.
There's a craving to have that kind of life again, where everything is very exciting all the time, and you're very, very taken care of, and everybody does everything for you. It's very seductive.
Just as quick as you had it, it can go. It's just much more harmful than never have had it before.
Here on BBC One, in 50 minutes, New York School for the Performing Arts is the setting for Fame.
The TV series was a spin-off from Fame the movie. Characters change, but the story was the same. The series followed a group of students with different backgrounds and talents, but all with the same ambition, to achieve fame. Its success in the States was eclipsed by the heights it reached in Britain. It was a phenomenon.
The kids from Fame have turned television fiction into fact.
The producers put the songs and dance on the stage and took Fame on the road.
I didn't even know how much we were loved till we got off that airplane in London, and there were hundreds of people there to meet us at the airport, and then they were rocking the bus.
First stop on their 8-day visit will be Brighton, followed by Birmingham and London's Albert Hall.
It was the first time I'd seen the vigil of people lighting a match, and they knew all the songs. I mean, I thought we would like the Beatles all of a sudden. I was like, oh my God.
Six central characters created the unique Fame chemistry. Stubborn dancer Leroy, determined actress and singer Coco, wisecracking comic Danny, bubbly ditzy actress Doris, and the shy musical genius Bruno. You could say. And ruling them with an iron fist and her wooden cane was dance teacher Lydia Grant.
Fame, will you welcome Valerie Landsberg? Val, welcome to Top of the Pops.
The kids from Fame achieved three top 20 singles, and the album hit number one for 12 weeks.
From the television series Fame.
The kids from Fame.
But I know I'd only last for a couple of days.
For the first time in 20 years, we are bringing together the leading stars of Fame to recall their adventures on and off screen, and to perform their highest charting single, Star Maker.
We're going to Debbie Allen's dance studios in Culver City, and we're having the big reunion. Bruno had this sense of wanting to break down the old conventions and replace the real acoustic strings and instruments with synthesizers.
Will you please stop being funny?
I wasn't being funny. Violins are on the way out. It's the truth.
I spent a little while last night learning Star Maker again, because it's been over 20 years since we all played and sang that song.
Bruno had the best of the best. He had all these, a mini Moog, and he had an ARP, and he had things that were thousands of dollars at the time.
If you've got a keyboard and some oscillators and the right combination of waveforms, you wouldn't need to make all these dinosaur tracks.
You know, the idea of having access to those electronic instruments was just a dream to me, you know.
I want you to give your undivided attention and a great big hand to a new kid on the block, a star of tomorrow, Danny Amatullo.
Friday night's gonna be all right, it's gonna be right, it's gonna be all right now, baby. Friday night's gonna be all right, gonna be right. Something like that, right?
I think the character Danny was a little more subtle. I don't think he was as abrasive as Carlo is.
I'm not a dancer or a singer. I'm a comedian.
Do you see me laughing, Amatullo?
No.
Then you better start singing and dancing.
I saw Jean a few years ago in Milan. I just saw Valerie last week, so you had to invite her.
Erica, I, run into in town sometimes.
Coco Hernandez was an amazing character. I think one of the greatest things about her was that she never took no for an answer. I mean, this is somebody who was like, I'm going there, and I'll do whatever I have to do to get there.
Mr. Martelli, it is so sweet of you to give us a ride.
That's no big deal, honey. Where are we going?
We're going to 121 Christopher Street.
Well, that's just around the corner.
I know.
We could have met us there.
But it looks so much better to pull up in a cab, don't you think so?
I was in school, and the director of the drama department told me I got the part. And I literally wept. I was like, really? I was like happy and terrified and scared at the same time, because it was a feeling of like, wait a minute, but I love my school. Where am I going?
Erica Gimple, who played Coco, was very serious about being an actress.
You ain't seen or heard the best of me yet. We're going to handle that right here and now.
She didn't really know how to dance so well. She learned. But she would always say, why do I have to dance, and why do I have to move and be so sexy.